Good evening, I'm Susan Ormiston, and this is The National. A Calgary woman posts a video of herself enduring a racist rant.
Take your head towel off in this country.
Wait till you hear what happened next.
I felt that I needed to stand up for her.
A motion to strip the name of Sir John A. Macdonald from all Ontario schools sparks a fiery debate. Her husband was found guilty of raping her. Then came the unexpected.
Well, I've never seen anything like it.
Duncan McHugh investigates the mistrial. London's royal parks have hired some new landscapers.
The sheep are fantastic lawnmowers.
And they bring their own uniforms. Lost in Manitoba, a woman did what any of us might do, stop and ask for directions. She could never have expected the response she got, a racist, Islamophobic verbal attack from a man who said he was a Nazi. It happened last month, but the video only came to light now. Karen Pauls has our story.
You are being racist.
Yeah, no shit I am.
You are being racist.
Nazi bitch.
Kaniz Fatima is still shocked that the man she asked for help reacted like this.
Take your head towel off in this country then.
Yeah, why should I take it off?
First, I felt insecure. I was concerned about my safety and I was concerned about safety of my family members.
It all began when Fatima and her family got lost about an hour and a half northeast of Winnipeg. The man she asked for directions started berating her. Her husband began recording it on his phone.
Go back to your
country. This is my country.
No, sir.
Yeah.
Soon after, two women came to her defense.
Excuse me. You're being racist.
What are you doing?
What's the problem? They have
Alicia Gertson is one of those women.
I don't know if it has to do with being possibly bullied in my life or just watching other people put people down all the time. Someone needs to say something.
I felt that I needed to stand up for her and for her family against this closed-minded prick.
Fatima moved to Canada from Bangladesh in 2009. She became a Canadian citizen in 2014.
That man does not represent Canada at all.
Today, Global News says it spoke to the man in the video. He says he's not a Nazi, but used another racial slur.
I got mad. The tourists wouldn't leave me alone, so I got mad. I didn't want to talk to them. That's it.
This Muslim leader worries about the open allegiance to white supremacy, like we saw in this month's violent protests in Charlottesville. But she's also concerned about those ideas going unchallenged.
We know that the majority of Canadians are not racist. They're not Islamophobes. They're not anti-Semites. But if the majority remains silent, guess who's speaking for us?
Fatima says posting the video on social media and filing a police complaint is her way to stand up for herself and other Muslim women.
At the same time, I wanted to increase the awareness amongst the Canadians that was happening.
According to Statistics Canada, reported hate crimes against Muslims are up in almost every province, from 99 in 2014 to 159 one year later. And while these kinds of incidents are getting a lot of attention, Jewish people remain the most targeted religious minority in the country. Karen Pauls, CBC News, Winnipeg.
Well, challenging racism is what a teachers' union in Ontario was trying to do when it passed a motion saying schools named after Canada's first prime minister should be renamed because of Sir John A. Macdonald's treatment of Indigenous people. Today, that drew reaction across the country. Stephanie Skinderis reports.
Felipe Pereja says he can only imagine how an Indigenous student in a school named after Sir John A. Macdonald might feel.
Walking into a building named after somebody who is quite literally responsible for the genocide of Indigenous peoples, that's dark.
Pereja put forward the Elementary Teachers Federation of Ontario's motion to rename those schools. He says it's the right thing to do.
That it's our responsibility to promote and do everything that we can to foster learning environments that are safe, that are inclusive, and where students feel like they are represented and where they are, you know, welcome.
The idea has touched off a heated national debate.
I don't think they should be renaming the schools at all.
I don't know why they're holding on to that name so strongly, and I think they should just listen instead of fight back.
Today, Ontario's premier said the teachers have missed the mark, adding, "I don't believe his name should be removed from schools in Ontario." Saskatchewan's premier called it a slippery slope, one that threatens the preservation of all our history. Wall's own province has seen a similar push to remove the names of historical figures associated with the residential school system, such as Regina's Dewdney Avenue, named after Edgar Dewdney, a member of Macdonald's cabinet. Ryerson University in Toronto is also facing a growing call to distance itself from Egerton Ryerson, also linked to residential schools.
It's completely silly and frivolous.
One professor says renaming is wrong.
The John A. Macdonald's contribution to Canada is so immense. When we, in the 21st century, cast judgment on the 19th century, we have to be a lot more humble.
But for some who have felt the impact of residential schools, removing Macdonald's name acknowledges reality.
Sir John A. Macdonald, he's no longer here to experience the pain and suffering that our people today are feeling as a result of his policies. And, you know, this is about our children today. This is about the next generation.
This is not about erasing history. This isn't about rewriting history. This isn't about revisionist history. This is about the fullness of our history.
Individual school boards in Ontario are responsible for naming or renaming schools. That means local trustees have to decide if schools like this one will get a new name. Stephanie Scandaris, CBC News, Toronto.
Senator Mike Duffy is suing the Senate and the RCMP for the damage done to his name. Duffy is looking for about $8 million for damages and for loss of income and benefits. The 71-year-old was suspended without pay from the Senate for 2 years while his expenses were investigated. And last year, an Ontario judge dismissed all 31 criminal charges of fraud, bribery, and breach of trust filed against Duffy. Judy Foote says she's putting her family first.
I'm indebted to the people who made it possible for me to have this incredible privilege to serve them, our province, and our country.
She's leaving politics after a total of 9 years as an MP and 11 as an MHA. In the spring, she took an indefinite leave as Federal Minister of Public Services. The Prime Minister said Foote will be missed immensely. Well, we haven't mentioned the government's beleaguered Phoenix pay system recently, but it doesn't mean that problems with public servants getting paid incorrectly have been fixed. In fact, our colleagues at Radio-Canada discovered that more people have been tangled up in the fiasco than ever before. Katie Simpson has that story.
Maxime Pedneau has run the gauntlet of public servant pay problems. The senior policy advisor from Health Canada was underpaid, then overpaid, and his issues still haven't been sorted out. Issues that started 18 months ago as the government introduced its new payroll system called Phoenix.
The main issue for us is the constant anxiety because we never know when you will receive a full paycheck, a partial paycheck, a double paycheck.
Pedneau is not alone. Documents obtained by Radio Canada show nearly half of all federal public servants have pay problems. Right now, 156,000 employees are not being paid properly. It's a dramatic jump from 80,000 workers about a year ago.
Phoenix! 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 When?
Now!
Union officials are frustrated. They're learning about the full scope of the debacle from the media rather than the government.
It's a tremendous missed opportunity for the government to be honest and transparent and to share the information necessary.
Since the initial backlog, Ottawa has not released the overall number of public servants experiencing Phoenix-related pay issues. Instead, it quantifies the problem by the number of outstanding transactions that need to be fixed, which can be confusing since an employee can have multiple transactions covering a range of problems. Today, the government did not offer any clarity.
But how many people?
Well, again, we track transactions. We know
that's not true. We know you track people. We've got the document, so how many people?
Well, what you have is an estimate that comes in from departments, but the
Is that estimate accurate?
The absolute, well, the what is accurate is the number of transactions that are outstanding.
Steve McKinnon blames the spike in problems in part on new collective agreements that need to be implemented for tens of thousands of unionized employees. Despite putting more than $400 million toward fixing the Phoenix system, hiring dozens of compensation advisors, and creating a task force on the issue, there's still no timeline on when the system will work as intended.
The Liberals have been in power for 2 years, and there's still no solution on the table for our public servants. They should be ashamed of that.
The Liberals never missed the opportunity to point out it was the previous Conservative government that developed the Phoenix system and cut corners in jobs, which they say caused all of these problems. Still, it is the Liberals that seem to have the problems coming up with any solutions. Susan.
Katie, the minister responsible for Phoenix, Judy Foote, we've just said, resigned today. We don't know who's going to replace her, but what will her replacement be walking into with this?
Well, one thing to make very clear, Judy Foote leaving cabinet has absolutely nothing to do with the Phoenix pay system. It has to do with a family health issue, not this mess that is currently going on at Public Services and Procurement Canada. Whoever walks into this new role could become a political sacrifice for the Liberal government. There is no easy solution here. There's no foreseeable future. There's no timeline when it will be fixed. So whoever is walking into this position will likely face some very heated criticism and could become unpopular quite quickly.
All right. Thanks very much, Katie.
Thanks.
For Canada's 300,000 public servants, the issues with Phoenix are monumental. The plan to centralize the government pay system was unveiled by the Conservatives in 2009. Instead of employing 2,400 people across the country, Phoenix required just 550 people, all in Miramichi, New Brunswick. Expected savings, $70 million. The rollout began in February 2016, but problems were immediate. Complaints mounted, tens of thousands of people paid improperly or not at all. Last summer, the deputy minister said all files would be processed by November 2016. That clearly didn't happen. In May, the government said the cost to fix Phoenix and the problems it created was more than $400 million. A big change is coming for some key ID in this country. Starting August 31st, Canadians can opt for a neutral gender on passports and immigration documents. The designation of an X will be available for those who don't identify as male or as female. Under international aviation law, sex must be listed on travel documents. A handful of countries, including Australia and Denmark, already allow for a third designation on passports. To stem the surge of thousands of Haitian asylum seekers to Canada today, a Quebec MP tried to address the problem at source. He was in the United States trying to strike a careful balance of Canada as a place with open arms but not open doors. Catherine Cullen explains.
There are plenty of smiles, but Quebec MP Emmanuel Dubourg is trying to tread a careful line as he meets with Miami's Haitian community. Since July, thousands of Haitians have walked across the Canada-U.S. border wanting to be arrested so they can claim asylum. So many camps have been set up to help process them. Dubourg's message to the Haitian community is not to stop coming.
I'm not telling the Haitian people no, they are to not coming to Canada. No, they are welcome to Canada, but there is ways to do that.
He says they should have all the facts.
It's not a free ticket to come to Canada.
Here in Miami's Little Haiti, there is plenty of worry. Tens of thousands of Haitians living in the U.S. have temporary protected status, and there are fears that status could run out in January. Farah Larieux says Canada seems like a much better option for some than returning to struggling Haiti.
It's a human instinct, surviving. So they know that Haiti is not ready for them. They know they don't have anything in Haiti. They know they're going to suffer.
Then there's the misinformation about how easy it is to get into Canada.
That it is easier to obtain political asylum, things like that. That they will receive work permit and then residency.
Dubourg says those that do come run a risk. If their claim fails, and about half of Haitian claims do, they could be deported.
And if we deport them, the door is completely closed, even though for them or for the family for next time.
Instead, Dubourg points to other avenues, like applying under economic programs. But Dubourg's conversations with local leaders left some unimpressed.
The country is in need, and any move by the U.S. or by the Canada or by the Canadian government to repatriate those Haitians to get back home, that's going to be very, very difficult.
It was clear his message was to the Haitians here in South Florida, don't come to Canada. And I was a little disappointed in that.
So clearly there's some confusion about precisely how welcoming Canada wants to be. The big question is whether any of that will change the mind of anyone planning to head for the border. Catherine Cullen, CBC News, Miami.
The wildfire season in British Columbia is unprecedented, and a new estimate points to another staggering fact. So far, the fires have pumped 190 million tons of greenhouse gases into the air, three times the province's annual carbon footprint in just a few months. It's a destructive cycle. Climate change creates drier conditions for forest fires to last longer, and the burning fires in turn contribute to more climate change. And yet another wildfire has broken out in BC's southern interior, prompting more evacuations tonight, this time in the Joe Rich area east of Kelowna. The fire started this afternoon and has ballooned in size since then to about 300 hectares. Some homes are now just a couple of kilometers away. More than 1,000 people have been ordered to leave the area. Well, summer's almost over, sadly, and BC school districts have posted a new sign, Help Wanted. That's straight ahead.
And to whittle down that big bank of points, expect more expensive and exotic rewards, like maybe 500,000 Aeroplan points for tickets to the Stanley Cup Finals next year. Or U.S. Airways says 10 million miles may get you to the moon someday.
Later, she told me haltingly, her two sons, Stanley and Parapum, were killed.
Trois et quatre ans?
Oui. Non, trois ans, deux ans.
Trois ans, deux ans.
They were 2 and 3 years old.
Just imagine 1,000 boats of all shapes and sizes. Many have never navigated the Thames ever before. They'll be bunched up according to size with the hope that if one does nudge against another, a large vessel will capsize a smaller one.
Wow. This is the cockpit of the plane.
European monitors claim today that some of the large pieces of wreckage like this one have been cut into with a power saw.
This is the flashpoint right here. The potential for the partition. Watch it. Right here. Look at the crowd move.
Several times in the 5 days we were in Crimea, our cameraman was attacked, pushed away. Eventually, we felt unsafe to go into those crowded areas, for example, around the parliament.
It was a nice idea once. Back in 2008, the first couple locked up their love on the bridge and then tossed their key into the Seine as a sign of their undying devotion. You'd think it was a French thing, but no, the idea came from Serbia. Once Paris got a hold of it, there was no stopping it. If there were any question about Russia's sustained role in Syria, here's one answer. A Russian symphony, secured and protected largely by the Russian military in a place revered by Syrians. Susan Ormiston, CBC News, Palmyra, Syria.
Wow. Quite a few experiences there over the years. And coming up in the next commercial break, I'll be taking your questions live. What's it like covering a war zone, a disaster, or reporting on the Queen? Leave a question in our comments and we'll try to get to all of them. Looking forward to it. Back to school preparations are furiously underway across this entire country, but in British Columbia, there's one essential in short supply, teachers. The province has hundreds of openings and times running desperately short. Renee Filipponi has that story.
With less than 2 weeks till the school year, the race is on to find teachers to fill BC classrooms. Dozens of school districts are still searching for hundreds of teachers. There are more than 400 job openings across BC. Vancouver alone posted 280 jobs this week.
The school districts are working very hard and we're supporting them in their efforts, and we're anticipating that the vacancies that are open will be filled.
The main reason? A Supreme Court of Canada decision from last fall that ruled class sizes had to be reduced.
There's about 3,500 jobs being created by the Supreme Court decision, but on top of that, a lot of school districts, not just the rural and remote school districts, but even in the Lower Mainland, were having shortages on a day-to-day basis.
A national recruitment campaign was launched to search outside the province.
We contacted faculties of education across Canada, and we attended actually every career fair across Canada this last year in anticipation of this year's vacancies.
It's really hard for teachers in Ontario right now.
Maggie Hicks graduated with her teaching degree in 2016. She says getting a full-time job in Ontario can take years and is contemplating a move to BC.
Finances are a bit of an issue. The cost of living out there is quite high, and I have also heard that the pay is less than it is in Ontario. And yeah, I'm just a bit hesitant to pack up and leave.
Salaries in BC are below the Canadian average, and that's been part of the recruitment challenge.
We've proposed lots of ideas, from student loan forgiveness programs to helping people with moving expenses, being a little more flexible with unpaid leaves.
The province says it is working with school districts to help in rural and remote areas. The ministry has created a $2 million fund for recruitment incentives, but it says wages and any other terms of employment must be decided through contract negotiations. Renee Filipponi, CBC News, Vancouver.
Tropical storm Harvey was upgraded to a hurricane today, causing many in Texas to brace for potentially devastating rains and flooding.
We are going to, in the strongest possible terms, encourage the residents in the low-lying areas, as they say, get out of Dodge.
People are clearing out of Corpus Christi, where Hurricane Harvey could hit as early as tomorrow night. Harvey continues to gain strength as it churns across the Gulf of Mexico. It's forecast to make landfall as a Category 3 storm. Rescue workers are still looking for at least 8 people after a massive landslide in a remote part of Switzerland. Authorities say they've been missing for at least a day. Part of a mountainside gave way yesterday with such force it registered a magnitude of 3. London's Westminster Borough is famous for grand parks, lush gardens. One could imagine legions of groundskeepers working around the clock to keep things neat and tidy. But these days, you're more likely to see a squad of hungry, dedicated sheep munching away as part of a conservation effort championed by Prince Charles himself. Margaret Evans has more on these four-legged lawnmowers hard at work near Buckingham Palace.
Morning in the park, Green Park, central London. There are the joggers, the stretchers, the early morning commuters, and now the sheep. That's right, the sheep. Just across the street from Buckingham Palace, too. They arrive for a 9 a.m. shift, chauffeured by their very own personal shepherd, Tom Davis, and his dog, Mavis. Their mission, and there's very little chance they'll refuse it, is to tear down those weeds.
Sheep are fantastic lawnmowers. You know, so if you've got a fair number of sheep, it's an amazing thing to do.
It's part of a conservation trial called Mission Invertebrate, supported by Prince Charles and aimed at promoting more biodiversity in wildflower fields, and so more pollinators. Dr. Alice Lawton is the team leader.
They'll naturally eat the more dominant shrubby plants, and in doing so, they leave space for the less dominant plants to grow up so that we get a greater variety of vegetation next year.
It's a huge crowd pleaser, not least because the 6 commuter sheep turning up here for 1 week only are themselves rare breeds.
They're very chubby, they're well coat, they're lovely, and they look very happy, and they love their crab apples.
We don't have enough of things like this preservation. You know me, I'd save the planet a bag at a time, but you have to try. Yeah. I just think it's great.
Davis has agreed to take his prize sheep out for a photo op, but not without a little touch-up first. Davis prides himself on being an urban farmer.
And this one is juniper. This is a breed called the white-faced woodland. And this is Olivia, and Olivia is an Oxford down.
The sight of a man out walking his sheep in such an exclusive postal code does tend to turn heads. The last time sheep were allowed to graze across from Buckingham Palace was in the 1920s and 30s. Juniper, Olivia and friends, though, are unfazed by all the attention. Those who aren't watching sheep are surely counting them. And before you know it, a hard day of eating is done.
That's it for another day. Back again tomorrow.
Nice work, if you can get it. Margaret Evans, CBC News, London.
Just ahead, a legal drama with an extraordinary result.
We had a really bad feeling that there was a gathering of the old boys to save one of them.
It left this woman feeling robbed of justice. That's next. Let's check the day's business numbers. The TSX edged up slightly. The dollar increased 0.2 cents. In New York, the Dow lost 28 points and the price of oil decreased 98 cents a barrel. Hi there. Welcome to The National on Facebook Live. Thanks for joining us. I've got some of your questions coming in. I'll take many more. I've got to put on my specs to see them, though, on my phone. I like this one. Josh Chilcott asks, what was your first car? I had to think about that, Josh. I think it was a blue, like this color, Toyota Corolla. Back in Saskatoon in grade 12, it was used car. I've never bought a new car. And it was perfect for getting me the mile and a half to my high school. I saved up my savings from summer, I think, to buy part of it or to help get help with dad. Anyway, I left it behind when I went to university in Ottawa and didn't get a car for a long time after that because I used public transportation here in Toronto and elsewhere. All right. Here's one from Alan R. How many countries have you reported from? Well, I did count them up recently, and I think it was 28 to 30. Actual countries that I've reported from. I hope to add to that. I really love going to new places and visiting some of the old conflicts that I've looked at, like Afghanistan for many years when Canadians were there. But it is a privilege to report from there back to you all here in Canada. Nolian Sija, I probably didn't pronounce that correctly. Are you ever told to make fake news? Never. End of conversation. Never, ever, ever. In fact, I bridle at the idea that we're talking about fake news. News is facts, and that's essentially what is the basis of what we do as journalists. Do you ever, Wendy Linnett, do you ever communicate with Peter Mansrich? How is he doing? Yes, we hear from Peter infrequently. I mean, it's summer, and he's probably kicking up his heels, maybe having a beer or two and just enjoying not having to be on call all the time. I expect we will see him back here as we develop this new exciting project we've got going on here at CBC News, the new National, which is launching in November. I suspect that although he won't be standing here, and in fact this whole set is going to be dismantled in about 10 days, he will be coming back to check in on us and probably give a few suggestions and a little bit of advice about how we're doing. So I'm sure Peter's doing just fine. I know he had a great summer planned. Roger Delgado asks, oh, Roger, I love this question. What's your favorite candy? How did you know I had a sweet tooth? Like, unbelievable sweet tooth. And jujubes are my cocaine. Honestly, I eat them frozen from the freezer. My mother-in-law buys them for me when I'm visiting her in the summer, and I do. I can't help it. I love jujubes, and the sour ones best. Betty Marshall asks, how long have you worked for CBC? That's kind of asking a girl how old she is, Betty. A long time. Several years. I'm sorry. A long time. Anyway, enjoyed every minute of it. Well, almost every minute. John Corman asks, what story do you wish you have covered? Great question, John, and lots of them. But I was thinking about that, and it's more what era I wished I had covered, and that was the civil rights movement in the United States back in the 60s. And the Underground Railway that happened here, Harriet Tubman and the Underground Railway that came up north to Canada. It was a momentous time of change and conflict and struggle in North America, and it would have been amazing to be a journalist and to watch and help and shape some of that coverage. But man, we have lots of stories like that yet. Gotta go, take off the specs, keep watching. Thanks.
Maybe this is something that somebody's trying to hide.
Well, at first, it seemed like a straightforward, albeit tragic case. An Ontario woman accused a man, her husband, of sexual assault. After a trial, he was found guilty. But in the blink of an eye, everything changed. At sentencing, the verdict was suddenly dismissed. The woman left shocked and wondering what happened. Desperate for answers, she contacted our Duncan McHugh. And here's what he found out about the mistrial.
It's a chilly day in May outside the courthouse in Pembroke, Ontario, when Isabel Raycroft arrives, a 76-year-old mother and grandmother here for the most unlikely of reasons.
We'll all congregate around mom.
Purple ribbons all round for each of these volunteers gathered to silently support Isabel and her daughters, who've come to ask the court to lift a publication ban on a criminal trial they fear may stay under wraps.
It's official.
It's official, okay.
Thank you.
It was the one time that the judge specifically, a judge specifically said, and I will remind you that there is a publication ban. And it planted the seed that, well, maybe this is something that somebody's trying to hide.
In but 2 hours, it's over. Isabel is now free to tell her story.
That means we won.
A moment of celebration in a journey that's been long, painful, and shines a spotlight on domestic violence in rural Canada. She was, for a long time, Isabel St. James, divorcee, single mom at age 27, raising her three girls on the family farm in Quebec. Debbie, Janet, and Sharon eventually moved away, married, had families of their own. But their mother never seemed interested in marrying again.
I would say she's happy-go-lucky, high-energy.
Independent.
Yeah.
Strong.
I had described her recently as like a mischievous elf.
Yeah. A gypsy a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it came as a bit of a surprise when Isabel, age 69 and single more than 40 years, announced she was in love with a retired farmer from Arnprior. Like so many small towns in the Ottawa Valley, Arnprior is a tight-knit community, a place with a county fair and deep-rooted farming traditions. This is where Elmer Raycroft raised his family, became a car salesman, and eventually deputy mayor. In 2009, a year after the death of his wife of 50 years, Elmer met Isabel on an internet dating site.
He said, go on the McNabb Brayside website and you'll see me there on the website. All the committees that he belonged to and that he was deputy mayor.
Was being deputy mayor a big deal to him, to Elmer?
Yes. Yes, I think so.
This is Elmer Raycroft's farm, a modest home upon 100 acres, the home he'd soon share with his new wife. On May 21st, 2011, Elmer and Isabel were married, but soon after, what she calls Elmer's episodes of irrational jealousy began and quickly escalated.
He threw a glass of water in my face. So that really, that was the first time that he just threw something at me.
6 weeks into their marriage, after she alleged Elmer forcibly dumped her out of a chair, Isabel headed for the police, filed a report, and spent two nights at a daughter's house.
I should have gone and I should have pressed charges, but I didn't.
Why not?
Because I loved him, because I hoped he said he would change. He cried and I cried. Well, you know how it is.
She later recanted that police report, then stayed quiet for 3 years about the goings-on at the farmhouse. But the conflicts grew more and more violent. She said he threw a mug at her, choked her with a belt, smothered her with a pillow, and in jealous rages, would check her for semen, not his own.
And he says, aren't you going to take a shower and get rid of all the sex off you? Well, then, you know, I started to move, but he said, I'm going to check you for semen, and he was pulling at my legs, and I screamed, you know, but I was bruised all over where he was pulling at me.
When those kinds of things started to happen, did you tell anyone?
No, I didn't tell anybody.
But in Isabel's marriage, it was getting harder to hide. 3 years in, after Isabel and Elmer's winter stay in Florida, her daughters began to worry that she hadn't called upon her return.
I said, okay, Mom, what's going on? What exactly is going on? Like, you're not well, you haven't come to see us, you've been home for 2 weeks now. You would always be, I know you're sick, but like, what's going on? So she started to cry, I started to cry.
It's okay. I'm not gonna cry, so you're not gonna cry. Look at me sucking it up. So Sharon spoke to Mom, and Mom told her,
okay, my turn, and Mom told her that Elmer had been abusing her.
The sisters devised a scheme, convincing Isabel and Elmer to drive to Janet's house, ostensibly so Isabel could care for a grandchild, but really to get their mother alone. Isabel never did return to her husband. Instead, went to the police, and days later, Elmer was charged with 7 counts of assault and sexual assault. The trial lasted 5 days before Justice Jane Wilson. Isabel testified, detailing multiple abuses, including sexual intercourse without her consent. I said, don't do anything. I don't want to do anything. Then he proceeded to pull off my pajamas, she told the court. He raped me, and I walked around the house for days telling him he raped me. Elmer denied all the charges against him, saying any intercourse or intimacy with Isabel was always consensual. When asked if he'd checked her for semen, he said, that never happened. I did not do that. Elmer suggested Isabel made false accusations because he wouldn't sell his 100-acre farm.
That is not true. There's no truth in that at all. Absolutely none. I would have stayed there if Elmer had been normal. But I could no longer live like that. I could no longer live on the edge.
Justice Wilson left no doubt who she believed in her decision. The court rejects his evidence, she wrote, as it relates to the assault with the belt, the choking, the sexual intercourse, the checking for semen, and the sexual assaults in the vehicle. His evidence does not give rise to a reasonable doubt in the court's mind. Justice Wilson found Elmer Raycroft guilty on 6 counts. But then, something unexpected. She fell ill before she could deliver the verdict. Instead, Justice Hugh Fraser read her judgment in court, and the task of sentencing Elmer also fell to him.
Specifics of the actual act?
Yes.
On the day of sentencing, Janet Mathut sat by her phone waiting for news from her mother and sisters.
You know, his own attorney had asked for 9 months in jail, which I guess was the low end of what he could get. So maybe I would see 9 months in jail. But what I saw was he got off.
In a decision that caught everyone off guard, Justice Fraser declared he'd read the transcripts and he had a reasonable doubt. Mr. Raycroft, said Justice Fraser, I'm declaring a mistrial. The guilty verdicts rendered by Justice Wilson have been vacated by me.
You know, I was walking around devastated.
Why?
Trying to put it behind me. Well, because I was angry. I was angry at this point. You know, how dare he get away with all that?
What had happened? First things first. When Elmer Raycroft was initially found guilty, he fired his lawyer and hired Ottawa criminal lawyer Rodney Seller.
Yeah, the trial judge found him to be a plausible witness. And under our criminal law, if there's a reasonable doubt and the Crown must prove the case beyond a reasonable doubt, the accused should be acquitted.
Justice Wilson did say Elmer's explanation of one sexual touching incident was, quote, plausible, but rejected his credibility. Justice Fraser focused on that word, concluding, I cannot proceed to sentence a man whose evidence at trial was considered worthy of belief, credible, and possibly true.
Justice Wilson said, Raycroft's version of events is plausible, but then she carries on to say, for reasons enunciated, I reject that evidence. And I want to just read to you a number of quotes from her decision. His evidence appeared contrived and self-serving. Evidence was weak at best, completely lacking in credibility. Suspicious, disingenuous, and lacks credibility. So my question is, if the trial judge clearly did not believe Elmer Raycroft, why was it right for Justice Fraser to step into Justice Wilson's shoes, take that extraordinary power, and to say that, to overturn the trial judge's decision?
I think where you're confusing it is you're calling it an extraordinary power. The code is very, very clear that if the judge is unable to continue, a second judge must take over. So the power is not extraordinary. It happens quite frequently. And it's exactly what the Parliament of Canada said should happen in this instance.
It's a really surprising case.
How come?
Well, I've never seen anything like it.
Robin Parker teaches international criminal law in Toronto, has worked as both Crown and Defense Counsel, and says this is one very unusual case.
It's pretty unusual for a judge who's sitting at the same level of court, review all of the same evidence, and then come to a different conclusion and speak it publicly. That was unusual. The second thing about it that was unusual was that the original trial judge in this case, not only did she see days and days of evidence, it was clear that she really wrestled with the evidence. And when she came to conclusions about credibility in the case, she gave specific reasons why she made the findings that she did.
Isabel Raycroft isn't sure how Justice Fraser came to his decision, but she has questions about the day she went to court for Elmer's pre-sentencing to give her victim impact statement.
And as I walked into the courtroom through the little anteroom, I couldn't believe all these people. Debbie was behind me, and I sort of stopped for a minute. These are all people that I knew, some people I had at my house for dinner. I'd play euchre with them.
It's common when sentencing an offender for defense to submit evidence of good character, and many in Arnprior were willing to go to bat for Elmer. They included Tom Peckett, the current mayor of McNabb Brayside. He'd known Elmer for decades and testified Elmer was very passionate about the people that he was working for and he believed wholeheartedly in his community.
When that happened, we had a really bad feeling that there was a gathering of the old boys to save one of them.
Speaker, it is time that this government...
Another politician also stepped up for Elmer.
...takes all measures to ensure that the children of today grow up in a society that will simply not tolerate any form of abuse or violence against women.
That's MPP John Jakubowski proposing a new law to keep victims of domestic violence safe, just a few weeks after he provided a character reference for Elmer, a convicted sex offender. That too was unusual, given that MPPs have been advised by Ontario's Ethics Commissioner to be cautious offering reference letters in court because, quote, Any involvement might be interpreted as an attempt to interfere with and or influence the legal process.
What's interesting about this case, though, is that the judge heard all of that evidence that wouldn't have been admissible at the trial, right?
The character references.
Right. Before declaring the mistrial.
The mistrial was appealed. That failed. A new trial will begin in 2017. Isabel will be 77. She insists on testifying again.
We women are not worthless. We make the world go round. And if you're being abused, then you must tell someone.
Why are you shopping like that?
She's cutting against the grain, given the number of people in Canada who report sexual assault remains dismally low. But backed by her daughters, Isabel Raycroft is resolute. She will be silent no more.
Cheers,
honey. It's an inside one.
Love you.
Sisters.
Thank you very much, girls.
Cheers.
Duncan McHugh, CBC News, Ottawa.
The new trial of Elmer Raycroft is set to begin on October 10th in Pembroke, Ontario. But there's more. He's been charged with another sexual assault against Isabel. He'll appear in court for that new charge on September 6th. Coming up, a dispute over a wine label spills onto Canadian shelves. Stay with us.
I think a lot of the fellas make a mistake looking for a girl that's absolutely perfect. Of course, I mean, you like to try and make her as almost perfect as you can, but, oh, I think you should learn to get along with the bad qualities and the good qualities.
What's your opinion on this business of going steady?
I think it's something that, it just shouldn't be.
You mean it hasn't happened to you yet?
Not exactly.
It will someday. Don't look so smug.
I started dating when I was about 12 or 13.
Well, so the prestige of having a boyfriend.
I don't know, I think you get too tied down. It's almost like getting married.
How do you make up your mind how far you're going to go on a date?
Well, it depends on the girl.
Well, I've recently met a fellow who believes that without exception, men, women, whether they're separated, divorced, or three-time losers, still cling to the hope that somehow, somewhere, there's someone just for them. He's Morton Victor, who tried to speed the process of natural selection by organizing a singles festival.
Being single could be very frustrating. It could be very depressing at times.
Just came to meet some nice young girl.
Well, maybe in the sense to meet somebody.
Well, to meet some girls.
You have to go looking for men?
No, I don't. But I mean, there's something new or something like that. I don't know.
Single and lonely and looking for love. A growing number of Canadians find themselves in precisely that situation these days.
The big problem today is the eternal one of finding someone who thinks you're as kind, sweet, sexy, sophisticated, witty, and intelligent as you know yourself to be. Where, oh where, to find such an extraordinary animal?
When your opening line is in a newspaper, you can say whatever you want. It's something single people in Toronto are doing more than ever.
You have total and complete anonymity.
Do you believe that you can find the woman of your dreams?
If you have the persistence to not be disappointed, by all rights, the heart should take over when you do meet the right person anyhow.
Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-day. My, oh my, what a wonderful day. Hey!
Ryan Gosling is on top of the world. Well, at least the entertainment world. He's a mouseketeer.
Hey, Ma, I'm home. It's really neat because he kind of laid low and he did, he said, you know, we picked out of a lot of talented kids and everything, Ryan, and, you know, I want you to know that you're a mouseketeer. And I went, no way. And my mom just, she hit the roof.
My biggest feeling was just that I was so happy for Ryan. I was happy that he was, that he got a yes answer.
Ryan had already caught a lot of eyes with his feet. He'd won an Ottawa talent show, Homegrown Cafe, and several dance competitions in the United States as well. But it was his clean-cut looks and his singing which won him an audition with Disney officials last month in Florida.
She that travel around this floor and you put you down. So people, let me put you high.
Now, after signing a one-year contract, he'll do singing and dancing on the Mickey Mouse Club.
to me, it's luck, because there was kids there that were just phenomenal, so luck.
The Trump White House seems to be trying to get back on track in at least one key policy area, jump-starting the stalled Mideast peace process. Trump's advisor and son-in-law, Jared Kushner, met with Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu today, reiterating a commitment to forge peace between Israelis and the Palestinians. Kushner also met separately with Palestinian leader Mahmoud Abbas. And there are many issues Israelis and Palestinians have yet to resolve. Territory and security, surely at the top of that list. But agriculture is also a source of friction. With limited land in the region, competition for good soil is fierce. One popular product has become a flashpoint for tension: wine. And arguing over the production of wine extends all the way to Canada. Derek Stoffel explains.
The ancient art of winemaking that dates back to biblical times thrives in the modern-day Holy Land. These Israeli boys making some extra money before school starts, helping with the harvest. These grapes, in a year from now, will become a high-end Chardonnay.
The grapes are amazing. Perfect color, perfect taste.
But even fruit cannot escape the politics of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. The location of these vineyards is controversial. This is the heart of the Israeli-occupied West Bank. Like most countries around the world, Canada considers the settlements here to be in violation of international law. Israel and many Israelis disagree. Amichai Lurie runs the Shiloh Winery, a boutique operation in a Jewish settlement that sits on land the Palestinians want for a future state. He sees it differently.
We're standing here exactly where the nation of Israel started.
Israel's government views the West Bank as disputed territory, and that's why wine produced here is labeled Made in Israel. But last month, Lurie got word of a swirling controversy in Canada. An order was issued to pull Shiloh wine and product from another nearby company from store shelves in Ontario. The regulator, the Canadian Food Inspection Agency, declared that since the grapes came from occupied territory, the label could no longer read Made in Israel. Under pressure from pro-Israeli lobby groups in Canada and Israel's embassy in Ottawa, the agency reversed its decision, allowing West Bank wine to remain a product of Israel. Half a world away in Winnipeg, David Kattenberg has launched what's believed to be the first Canadian challenge to the labeling rules.
This is my father, may he rest in peace.
Kattenberg is the child of Holocaust survivors, a university lecturer who has long supported the Palestinian cause.
I found it to be completely outrageous that these wines should be labeled Made in Israel when in point of fact they're produced in territory that the international community unanimously, including Canada, consider to be occupied territories.
This is another West Bank winery in the settlement of Sagot that also saw the labels on its bottles challenged. The owner lashed out online, calling Canada a country that conquered and destroyed the homeland of another people, that now questions the right of Jews to live and grow vineyards in the land of our forefathers. The European Union brought in guidelines 2 years ago that require labels to clearly state where West Bank products are made. That's something that should also happen in Canada, according to Peace Now, an Israeli group that opposes Jewish settlements.
I think that consumers should have the ability to make their own decision of what they support ideologically, and the location of where a product is made is a part of that decision.
Some pro-Palestinian organizations call for a total boycott of all products that come from Israeli settlements. But that is not David Kattenberg's goal. He wants product labels to accurately reflect product origin.
If Canadians knew that they were buying wines labeled made in such and such country, and it turned out that the wines were actually not made in those countries, they'd be pretty riled up.
With the legal challenge now underway in Canada, Amichai Lauriers vows that he won't back down.
I will not take out the words made in Israel under no circumstances. Even if I lose the market, I'll lose the market. No big deal.
As West Bank winemakers keep an eye on the presses that produce the essence of their products, they find themselves under growing pressure from this challenge in Canada, which they say is a significant market for their wines. Derek Stoffel, CBC News, Shiloh in the West Bank.
Up next, when does she have time to dry off? How swimmer Penny Oleksiak, a team and Team Canada swamped the world today.
The amazing Alouette has outperformed anything that's been shot into space since the Russians started it with Sputnik 1. The mere fact that it's still faithfully sending back messages from the top side of the ionosphere is enough to make it remarkable. When it was launched in September of 1962, its designers figured that with luck it would operate for a year. As of right now, it's been in orbit for 5 years and 7 months, and three of the six original batteries are still working.
It was a picture that Canadian engineers had waited 6 years to see, and for which Canadian taxpayers paid $100 million. A giant space robot with Canada's name on it and the Earth above. The remote manipulator system performing perfectly.
Okay, and be advised that we're looking at a great picture.
Good evening. It was a spectacular liftoff and a history-making day for Canada. The shuttle Challenger blasted off the pad at Cape Canaveral at dawn. On board, astronaut Marc Garneau, the very first Canadian in space.
This trip into space for me has turned out to be more than ever I could have hoped for. It's a great honor for me to represent Canada in space.
3, 2, 1, 0, and liftoff of the Space Shuttle Discovery and the first International Microgravity Laboratory.
Good evening. There's a Canadian in the heavens tonight, Roberta Bonder, going around in circles and entirely happy about it. Canada's second astronaut in space. She's orbiting planet Earth about 300 kilometers straight up. She left from this space center this morning, 59 minutes later than scheduled, but after a lifetime of anticipation, those minutes probably won't mean very much in the long run.
Incredible view.
A crucial spacewalk took place in the skies above us early today, and Canadian astronaut Julie Payette was in charge. Payette coordinated the mission from on board the Space Shuttle Discovery.
History was made high in the sky today. For the very first time, a Canadian walked in space. Early this morning, astronaut Chris Hadfield began installing Canadarm2, and with it, launched a new era for the International Space Station.
With great humility and pleasure, I accept command of the International Space Station.
Yeah, you know why I want to get back soon. You know why I want to get back soon.
The National. The National.
Tonight.
Canada's young female swimmers were some of the stars of last year's Rio Olympics, and today they proved they are still a force to be reckoned with. Olympians Penny Oleksiak and Taylor Ruck, along with Kayla Sanchez and Rebecca Smith, took gold today in the 4x200-meter freestyle relay at the World Junior Swimming Championships. But they didn't just win, they blew away the competition, hitting the wall nearly 6 seconds ahead of the second-place team, the Russian Federation, and setting a new junior world record. 6 seconds. Wow. That's the National for this Thursday night. Check our website, cbcnews.ca, for more news anytime. I'm Susan Ormiston. Thanks so much for joining us today.